Bonjour à tous. Hello, everyone. Today, I want to update you on all on three key elements of our fight against COVID-19: modeling, testing, and vaccines. Let me start with modeling. This morning, Dr. Tam and Dr. New presented new models that show the potential spread of the virus over the next few weeks. The reality is that right now, hospitalizations are still on the rise in many provinces. While vaccine doses are being delivered every week, we need to keep reducing in-person contacts. For the moment, that's the only way to get these numbers down. Since yesterday, Ontario is now under a stay-at-home order. This is the kind of tough but necessary decision that provincial governments are having to make. I spoke with Premier Ford directly on Wednesday, and I told him, as always, the federal government is here to help. We talked about rapid testing and the role that that could play in keeping these numbers down. We also, of course, let him know that federal help is available wherever needed, including and especially for long-term care homes. The outbreaks happening in long-term care homes in Ontario and across the country are not only incredibly concerning, they're also tragic. Our parents and grandparents built this country. They raised us, and they deserve so much better. And it is vital that we continue to get vaccines to vulnerable people as quickly as we can. And that's exactly what we're focused on. But remember, no one is invincible. Even if you're young and healthy, this virus can be dangerous. That's why we all have to keep doing our part. We're also constantly monitoring variants of COVID-19 with governments across the country, including the concerning Brazil variant. We're doing whatever it takes to protect Canadians, including looking at banning certain flights if necessary. Decisions must be based on public health guidance, and as always, our ministers are actively leaning in on this and talking to experts to reach a determination without delay. We will continue to keep Canadians informed of any new decisions we take. To people in Ontario now under the stay-at-home order, I know this isn't how you wanted to start the new year. It probably feels like a deja vu all over again from 2020. This won't last forever. But for now, we have to buckle down. This is our best way through in the coming weeks of winter. We've seen the kind of impossible choices hospitals in other countries had to face when they become overwhelmed. Deciding who gets an ICU bed and who doesn't, well, that's not where we want to be. So please, keep following public health guidelines and stay safe. Au Québec aussi, c'est important que les gens continuent de respecter les directives de santé publique pour diminuer le nombre de cas et faire baisser les taux d'hospitalisation. Comme vous le savez, la pandémie a des impacts bien au-delà de juste ceux qui testent positifs. Quand la COVID-19 met trop de pression sur les hôpitaux, c'est tout le système qui en écope. On apprend tous un nouveau mot, délestage. Des milliers de chirurgies sont en train d'être retardées. Les dépistages de certains cancers sont plus lents, ce qui met d'autres vies en danger. Les travailleurs de la santé sont épuisés, en plus de devoir prendre des décisions extrêmement difficiles. Je sais que c'est difficile et que les mesures sont strictes, mais pendant qu'on continue de vacciner les gens vulnérables, il faut absolument casser cette deuxième vague. Depuis le début, notre réponse à la pandémie est basée sur la science et sur les meilleures données possibles. Mais mercredi, pendant la retraite virtuelle du Conseil des ministres, différents experts sont venus faire le point avec nous, dont la Dr Tam, la Dr Niemer, le président de l'Agence de la santé publique du Canada et les deux coprésidents du groupe de travail national sur les vaccins. Ce matin, le premier rapport du comité consultatif d'experts sur les tests et le dépistage a été publié. J'aimerais d'abord remercier les deux coprésidents, Sue Pesch et le Dr Irfan Dalla, ainsi que tous les autres membres du comité. Depuis l'automne, on a distribué plus de 14 millions de tests rapides aux provinces et aux territoires. Le rapport du comité ce matin fait des recommandations pour que ces tests soient utilisés de manière optimale et efficace. le dépistage dans les lieux à haut risque comme les centres de soins de longue durée, les écoles et les différents milieux de travail est crucial dans notre combat contre la COVID-19. The Testing and Screening Expert Advisory Panel published their first report this morning. In it, they laid out evidence-informed advice on science and policy for COVID-19 testing and screening. The panel has identified four priority areas of action to reduce the spread of the virus, protect Canada's most vulnerable, and limit the impact of the disease on the healthcare system and on the economy. So far, we've sent more than 14 million rapid tests to the provinces and territories, with more on the way. Effective testing and screening is key to stopping COVID-19 transmission and limiting outbreaks in long-term care settings, schools, workplaces, and other high-risk locales. We all have to work together to use these rapid tests to slow the spread of the virus. Today, I also want to talk about where we are with vaccines. On Tuesday, I announced that we reached an agreement with Pfizer to buy an additional 20 million doses of their vaccine. Yesterday, Major General Fortin confirmed that as of today, almost a million vaccine doses have been delivered to the provinces and territories. We're working day in and day out to get vaccines delivered as quickly as possible. Shipments have largely been ahead of schedule so far. But with an undertaking this historic, it's only to be expected that there will be a few bumps along the way. Earlier this morning, Minister Anand talked about her conversation with Pfizer Canada regarding impacts to vaccine production. Due to work to expand one of the company's manufacturing facilities, deliveries to all countries receiving Pfizer doses made at the European facility will be temporarily reduced. This includes Canada. I want to be very clear, this does not impact our goal to have enough vaccines available by September for every Canadian who wants one. It will also not change our second quarter goals. Canada must still get ready for the ramp-up phase in Q2. This kind of issue is out of our hands, and that's why we pursued an aggressive procurement strategy in the first place. Canada has one of the most diverse vaccine portfolios in the world, and we secured the largest number of doses per capita of any country. We have 7 bilateral agreements to ensure flexibility when it comes to supply chains. And like I said, this situation with Pfizer is temporary. Cette semaine seulement, on a livré 380 000 doses de vaccins aux provinces et aux territoires, et les livraisons se poursuivent. On fait tout ce qu'on peut pour livrer le plus de doses de vaccins possible, le plus rapidement possible. Et à travers ce processus, c'est normal qu'il y ait des imprévus. Ce matin, la ministre Anand a expliqué qu'il y aurait un délai de livraison du vaccin de Pfizer qui aura un impact sur tous les pays qui reçoivent des doses de leur usine de fabrication en Europe, incluant le Canada. Je veux être très clair. Cette nouvelle n'a pas d'impact sur notre but de vacciner tous les Canadiens qui le désirent d'ici septembre prochain. Notre phase accélération du deuxième trimestre ne sera pas affectée non plus. C'est une situation hors de notre contrôle, mais on se souvient que c'est pour ça que le Canada est devenu le pays qui a le plus de doses réservées par personne au monde. Et nos ententes avec 7 fabricants et développeurs de vaccins font en sorte qu'on a une marge de manœuvre quant aux chaînes d'approvisionnement. Et d'ici septembre, vous allez tous pouvoir recevoir votre vaccin. I know it's been a tough 11 months. But no matter how much longer this crisis lasts, no matter where you live, we've got your back. Yesterday, a request for additional support was approved by the federal government for Nain in Newfoundland and Labrador. The Canadian Rangers will help with the vaccination effort, as many vulnerable and elderly people in the community need help getting to and from the vaccination site. In Ontario, we approved an extension for the Canadian Red Cross until March 31st to continue supporting isolation and recovery centres for temporary foreign workers in the Windsor-Essex region. And in Manitoba, an extension has also been approved so that the Canadian Red Cross can provide general support as well as support to personal care homes until March 31st. Far too many families are facing the heartbreaking realities of what's happening in care homes across the country. This is a crisis we all need to work together on. And as we have from the very beginning, the federal government will always be there when it's needed most. Before I wrap it up for today, I also want to take a minute to talk about housing. With rising homelessness and housing needs, the COVID-19 crisis has made it clear that affordable housing will be key to Canada's recovery. Everyone deserves a safe and affordable place to call home. In September, we announced an investment of $1 billion through the Rapid Housing Initiative. Today, we can announce the details of the over $203 million that was allocated for Toronto. The city will be starting 7 projects to create more than 500 new affordable homes. These will be prioritized for people experiencing homelessness. Of the total number of new homes, 20% will also be prioritized for Indigenous communities and 20% for women and girls. That takes us to nearly half of the new units that will go to people who are especially vulnerable when it comes to housing. Plus tôt cette semaine, le ministre Hussein a aussi annoncé un investissement fédéral supplémentaire de près de 40 millions de dollars pour accroître et étendre les mesures d'urgence afin d'aider les personnes en situation d'itinérance au Québec. Ce financement additionnel provient des fonds que nous avons annoncés en septembre dans le cadre du programme Vers un chez-soi. La COVID-19 a de graves répercussions sur les personnes en situation d'itinérance qui doivent faire face au froid et à toutes sortes de difficultés. Chaque Canadien mérite un chez-soi sûr et abordable et on va continuer de travailler ensemble pour bâtir un Canada inclusif qui ne laisse personne pour compte. Comme toujours, ensemble, on va bâtir un monde meilleur. Merci beaucoup.